We're going to start a new series today that we'll be doing for the next couple of weeks, just as the Lord leads us. And in doing that, I want to introduce to you our theme for 2017. All right, this is the theme I believe God wants us to be following this year. And I believe God has put this in my heart. He's confirmed it several times again last night. He confirmed it to myself and Mandy. And so I'm very excited what I believe God is going to do in and through our lives this year. And so the theme is actually also going to take us into a direction that I feel the Lord wants us to study in from the Word of God. But in saying that, before I introduce you the theme, I want to also just say that I want to encourage you to continue to exercise your faith in trusting God to complete the goals that we have set and that you have set for 2016. I mean, there's still some goals that maybe are outstanding. And, you know, as a local church, what we do is we present our vision and our goals on the 1st of March because we run it with our financial year. And so if you're part of this church, then I want you to know you still have 2 months to trust God to finish the goals of 2016. So, you know, pull out your vision sheet, keep trusting God, and keep moving forward. So our theme for 2017 is fast track. Fast track. Look at the person next to you, say fast track. And leading up to when we present the vision on the 1st of March, 2017, this year, I think it's really important that we begin to prepare ourselves and build our faith and study in the Word of God so that we can be positioned for what God wants to do. How many of you know there's a God side and there's a man's side? We have to work with the Holy Spirit and work with God if He's going to accomplish the things in our lives that I believe He wants to do this year. So let's start this morning. I'm going to give you the definition of the word fast track. And it's quite an amazing word if you just start to study it. And every week I'm going to add a little bit of a definition to it that will be fresh for that day. So here's the definition for this week. The word fast track, if you look it up just in your simple Webster dictionary, it says this. Fast track, a course leading to rapid advancement or success. All right? A course leading you to rapid advancement or success. Now, this morning, I want us to focus and put our attention on to the first part of that definition. It says there's a course that you and I can follow. And if we follow that course, it's going to lead us to rapid advancement and success. Now, I know we'd love to focus on the advancement and the success, but before you get to that, you've got to be on the right course. And that's what we're going to speak about and just focus about and focus on this morning just to kind of lay the foundation. We're going to break up these words, fast track, in a little bit of a way. And I want you to know that God has really impressed this word on my heart. Already starting in November last year, I've been thinking about it and praying about it and meditating on it. And I'm really expectant for what I believe God will do in our lives and in our church and in our community as a result of His Word. So we're going to break this word up. We've got fast and we've got track. All right, and so this morning we're gonna spend time on the second part of the word. We're going to look at the word track, which fits in with the definition, you know, a course leading us to the right place, leading us to advancement. And then the week after that, we're going to look at the word fast. And we're going to use a bit of a play on the word fast because we're not going to be fast. We are going to fast. Look at the person next to you and say, fast. And we want to invite you from today, start preparing, start thinking about, start putting into your spirit and renewing your mind, because in February, we're going to invite you and challenge you as a church to join myself and Mandy and the leadership on a Daniel fast. All right? How many of you have heard of the Daniel fast? Wave if you've heard of the Daniel fast. How many of you know about fasting? You've fasted in your life before as a believer. All right, so there's some of us who haven't. So we'll teach on that and we'll look at the significance of fasting in the New Testament. We don't want to do it according to the Old Testament. It's not a work. It's not something we've got to, you know, work up in the flesh. It's something that the Holy Spirit leads us to as we serve God at appropriate times. He'll call us to fasting, and it's biblical and it's powerful and it's incredible when we do it in the right spirit. Can you say amen? So we'll be doing that, and we'll be studying the Word of God, and I think it's going to be exciting that February we'll start preparing our hearts. We're going to go on a 21-day Daniel fast, but you don't have to go on a 21-day. Some of you are like, oh my word, I can't eat for 21 days. It's not that bad. If you drink water, you'll get there. No, we'll talk about fasting, and really, fasting is about your heart connection with what you're trusting God for. So you can fast TV, you can fast your newspaper, and maybe you're trying to give up smoking, so you can fast smoking for 21 days. Amen. And God will honor that. So we'll talk about it and how we can get into it. Maybe you feel you're not ready for that, so you're just going to do, you know, a one-day fast. That's fine. But let God speak to you, because I think we're going to have an incredible time together. So let's go to a couple of scriptures this morning, and let's start firstly in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And we're going to use some of these scriptures over the next few weeks kind of as our text, and we'll get into studying some of these and looking at some of the significance as it relates to the theme we want to focus on this year. Look at the person next to you, say fast track. I believe the Spirit of God is saying to you and I this morning, and I hope you can grab this promise, that wherever you are in your life this morning, whatever God is doing in your life, God is able to fast track your life. In other words, He's able to rapidly move you in advancement and success so that you can accomplish God's purpose for your life. So here in verse 12 from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, let's read the first 5 or 6 verses. It says, since we have such a hope. Say, such a hope. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold. Say, very bold. Not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end, but their minds were hardened, for to this day, when they read the old covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because it is only through Christ that it is taken away. Now, some people think, well, Moses put a veil on over his face because the glory of God was so strong that the people couldn't look at him. No, no. He put a veil over his face because the glory was fading. And he didn't want the people to see that the glory was fading, because in the Old Testament, how many of you know, the glory wasn't there permanently. And so the writer Paul of Corinthians, he says, listen, we have such a hope that we're not just bold, we are very bold, because we understand that if we're in Christ this morning, the veil is taken away. Say, taken away. The glory of God is living in you. Amen. And it's the glory of God that will shine through you as you serve Christ. And it goes on and it says, yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Say, freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed. Say, transformed. Into the same image, from one degree of glory to another degree of glory. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Now, there are a few words here that just jumped out at me, and I want us to just think about these by way of introduction as we think about the track God wants us to walk on. The track God wants us to walk on, he's saying, Larry, if you'll get onto this track, if you'll follow this course, it'll lead you to a place where you have success, where you have things speed up in your life that will move you quickly. In other words, think about things where you feel you've lost ground, where some of you feel like, man, I should be further than I am. God is able to fast track you into those places if you'll get onto the right track. Can you say amen? Look at the person next to you. Say, fast track. So here are the four words I want us to just we're not going to spend a lot of time on these, but I want to just drop them into your thinking this morning, and we'll build on them as we get into the teaching. Notice something very important, though, before we do that. It's in the Lord that the veil is lifted. It's in Christ that we have this victory and this strength. And it's in Christ that we're able to do these things. It's not in our own ability. It's not by our own works of the flesh. It's not by us struggling in our human nature. It's by us looking at the Lord, because it's in the Lord that the veil is removed. So here are the four words I want us to focus on. The first one is the word hope. Hope. We're living in a world today where hope is just not around as much as it used to be. And hope is such an important content of a believer's life. And the writer of Corinthians, the Apostle Paul, he says we don't just have hope, we have such a hope. Now, if you look at that word in the Greek, the word such there is the Greek word toitos. Not toy toy, okay, and not tortoise, but toitos. And it actually means this. It means that the Apostle Paul was describing a specific kind of hope. So he's saying, listen, you don't just have a hope like the world hopes, you know, like, oh, I hope things work out, and it's kind of empty and frivolous without substance. He's saying we have a specific hope. And this hope we have is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's solid and it's real and it has substance. Hebrews 11 says, faith is the substance of things hoped for. So hope this morning is really important to you and I. And God, through giving us this word or this theme for this year, he's saying, listen, I want you to have hope this morning. I want you to have vision for your life. I don't want you to let go of those things that I've put in your spirit in 2016 and forget about them. I want you to hold on to them as a treasure, because we have such a hope. He describes the character of that hope, and he says to us, it's this hope that will move us forward. Hope really, in a biblical sense, is the word vision. If you study that word in the Greek, it means to have a fond expectation of good. Isn't it amazing as a believer, no matter what you're facing in your life today, you can get up tomorrow and you can have an expectation of good. That's what God wants you and I to carry in our spirit. It speaks about you and I having spiritual vision and foresight in our lives. Number two, the second word is the word boldness. He says, because we have this hope, we have boldness. And I love the way he puts it. He doesn't just say, because we have hope, we're bold. I love what he says. He says, we are very bold. Would you look at the person next to you and say, very bold? Oh, come on. Say it like you actually are being it. Say, very bold. Very bold. This word bold speaks about having faith. Again, he uses the word very to describe the kind of boldness you and I can have before God. And this boldness is really a confidence. It's a confidence in God. It's a confidence that God is for you, that God is on your side, that God is working for your betterment. And so that confidence that comes into my spirit saying, you know what, I'm not only going to hope for this, but I'm going to be bold about what I'm saying. Not because I'm anything, not because I think I've got anything great to offer, but because I have this hope in Jesus. It produces a boldness in my life. Number three, the third word that I want us to just think about this morning is the word freedom. Freedom. He says, and look how they build on. He says, I have this hope, and this hope makes me bold. And this boldness which comes from the Spirit of God brings a freedom into my life. How many of you love freedom this morning? Hey, you know, freedom is an incredible, incredible thing. But very often as human beings, we misunderstand freedom. We think freedom is the ability to do whatever we want. But I want you to know, freedom isn't the ability to do whatever you want. Freedom is the liberty or the ability to choose what you're going to do and what you're not going to do. Because if you have freedom this morning, you have a responsibility before God and before mankind to do the right thing with your life. And so real biblical freedom, spiritual freedom this morning, is the ability to not have to be ruled by your flesh. It's the ability to make the right choices for your life so that your life lines up with the Word of God and as it says here, is transformed from glory to glory. Amen? So the fourth word is the word change. Because the word transform, there is the word change. Look at the person next to you. Say change. Change. We as humans don't really like change. We very often resist change. But I want you to know, if you're going to serve God, God is in the change business. Bump the person next to you. Say change is on its way. And the Apostle Paul starts to talk to us. He starts to say, listen, this transformation happens when the Holy Spirit starts to produce things in your spirit, when you start to have hope, when you start to have a boldness, when you start to see the glory of God working in your life and you realize the reality of freedom, what happens is it starts to transform you from the inside out. And I want you to know this morning, if you're gonna see God, how many of you would like God to fast track you? I can think of some areas right now, I'm like, God, if you could just fast track me in this area, I would really, really appreciate it. Can any of you just say, there's one area I'm thinking of right now. How many of you can say there are two? All right, so the Apostle Paul is saying, listen, God wants to take you from glory to glory. To glory. He's saying, I want to fast track your life into the purpose and the plan that God has for you. But here's the thing. You've got to allow this transformation to take place in you. Now, what is this image? What is this glory that God wants? The word glory here is an incredible word, and we don't have time to study it completely this morning. But the word, the image God wants to transform you into is into His image or into His glory. And that word glory means to show forth His splendor. Isn't it incredible this morning that God wants to show forth His splendor through your life? The word glory here is the word honor. It's the word renown. It's the word reputation. All right, God wants to display His reputation and His renown and His honor through your life. So let's build on this thought now of the course God wants us on. Let's drop into Matthew 17, the second scripture we're going to just have a look at this morning together. Luke 17 and verses 20 and verses 21. Verse 20 says this. Now when He was asked by the Pharisees, speaking about Jesus, when the kingdom of God would come, He answered and said to them. Now remember, the Pharisees were looking in the natural. And they were waiting for a ruler to come who would overthrow the Roman Empire and cause Israel to be, or the Jewish nation to be ruling in the natural. So they were fixated on the natural. And so they were like, Jesus, when is the kingdom coming? And look what He answers to them and says. The kingdom of God does not come with observation. Nor will they say, see here or see there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is within you. Say within you. Where's the kingdom of God this morning? So, the first place that God wants to fast track your life this morning is where? On the inside of you. You see, all of us, including myself, we always look at the outside. We always look at the circumstances or the situation or what we'd like to accomplish in the natural. But God never looks at that. God always looks at the inside. He looks within you because where is the kingdom? Inside of you. And so the first place God wants to fast track your life this morning is into a deeper, closer, and more intimate relationship with Him. Because God understands this. Listen, the closer I get to God, the more of God's glory I carry, the more power and influence I have on the outside. So we're always looking, God, when are you going to change my circumstance? When are you going to change my situation? When are you going to change my husband? Don't say amen. Lord, when are you going to change my financial situation? And you know what? Whenever you say that to God, God says, I'm ready to do it. Just adjust that attitude of yours. Just smile at me. It's okay. No one knows I'm talking about you. God says, you know that person you haven't forgiven yet? And what He wants to do is He wants to fast track you inwardly. Because when you and I are fast tracked inwardly, it starts to affect the way we deal with things outwardly. And you know what? Things start to change and things start to happen. Sometimes God doesn't change your outward circumstance, but He changes your inward attitude towards your circumstance. And that brings victory and release and success. Are you getting some help this morning? So I want to remind you this morning that our theme for today and for this year is fast track. And we're looking at the track that God wants us on. The course that is going to lead us to this rapid advancement that we want to experience in our lives. So turn with me now to 2 Timothy chapter 2. And we're going to kind of get into the heart of the message for this morning. 2 Timothy chapter 2. And we're going to read just 7 verses. And we're going to take a little bit of time to unwrap these a little bit this morning. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 1. It says, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer must be first to partake of the crops. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. Now, let me paint you a little picture this morning so that we can just help each other as we study this. The writer of 2 Timothy is the Apostle Paul. All right? And what will really help us to understand the context of what he's saying in the scripture is to understand the history and the reason why Paul wrote this chapter to his son, his spiritual son, Timothy. All right? So Paul writes this book of Timothy from prison. All right? And it's written round about AD 66 or 67. And it's during the time of Paul's second imprisonment. All right. Now, what we need to understand is that in Paul's first imprisonment, where he was imprisoned and persecuted for the sake of the gospel, he was kind of in a unique situation in prison. He was put into what they would call house arrest. Right? He had a house where he was able to live and sleep and move and study, and he could have visitors come and go, but he couldn't leave the house. He had guards around the house, and so he was imprisoned in that sense. But the second time he's imprisoned, he's actually put into a dungeon. Very few people were allowed to come and visit him. And actually, he started to realize that the only thing he had to look forward to was his death. He realized he was going to be martyred for his stance and for his preaching of the gospel. And so he writes this book of Timothy from that perspective. And really, he wrote it because he was so concerned about his son Timothy, his spiritual son, who was pastoring the church at that time in Ephesus and a few of the other places. And he writes this book from this attitude like, Timothy, I'm so concerned that you are not going to stay the course. That you're not going to keep your life on track with the gospel. Not only that, if you read the context of what he's writing, he's not only saying, Timothy, I'm concerned about you staying the course. He said, I'm concerned about making sure that the gospel that you're preaching stays on track and keeps momentum. And he says to Paul, to Timothy, Timothy, if you'll do these things, this is what'll motivate you to keep things on track. This will motivate you to cause the gospel to stay on course so that it can spread to the whole world. And this is what he says to him. He says, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. So there are a couple of things this morning that I believe the Lord really wants us to get a hold of in our lives today so that we can stay on track this year. We want the fast. How many of you know we always want the blessing? And that's great. God wants you to be blessed. But I want you to know there's a responsibility we have before God to do our part with that. And so he starts out, he says, number one, and you can write these down. I think there are five or six of them this morning that we look at. The first thing he says, Timothy, I want you to be strong in the grace that is in Jesus Christ. So the first thing that we've got to do if we want to stay on track this morning is we've got to realize that our strength comes from the grace of Jesus Christ. It comes out of the message of the gospel. It comes out of the finished work of God. And Timothy was receiving from Paul, and what Paul was saying to Timothy is this, I want you to draw deeply on your relationship with God. Manny and I were talking to Claude a couple of weeks ago between Christmas and New Year. And, you know, he's really at that stage now where he's homesick. How many of you, when you leave the country and you leave your, you know, you get to that place, you've got to push through the homesick phase. And he was just saying, you know, I'm homesick and this isn't right and that's happening and this is happening. He said, but I think he was talking to Mandy. He said, but you won't believe how I'm growing spiritually. He said, I'm getting so close to God. And so guess what was happening? The pressure that he's facing on the outside is pulling him into a closer relationship with God because he really doesn't have anyone else to rely on there other than his relationship with God. So how many of you know in the natural, it looks kind of a difficult time, but in the spiritual, it's the best time for him because God is pulling him into a closer walk with him. And that's what Paul was saying to Timothy here. He was saying, listen, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. So all these principles that I'm going to share with you this morning, I'm not asking you to do this in your strength. I'm asking you to do this in the strength that God supplies through his grace. Look at the person next to you, say grace. You see, grace is the source of God's spiritual riches and power. And when we find this grace in Christ Jesus, it motivates and it helps us to make the right choices in our lives. It empowers us to do the right thing at the right time. And I want you to know, it causes us to be in a place, think about this, God always does things at the right time. So listen, that tells me if things haven't fitted together yet, then maybe it's not the time. Amen. And if things are fitting together, then it is the time and you need to be ready to run with that opportunity. Touch the person next to you and say, be strong in grace. As we trust God and as we rest in Christ, his grace is manifested. God wants us to be strong and that strength comes as an ability. What does that strength do? That strength gives us the ability to stand during difficult times. To stand when everything around us feels confused and feels out of place, that grace keeps us centered in our relationship with Jesus. Amen? Number two, the second thing. Now, listen to what he says. He says, be strong in grace. And then he says, the things that you've heard and learned, commit them to faithful people. So the second thing this morning that God wants us to stay on track, this is where he wants us to walk and live. This is the course he wants us to follow, is number two, he wants us to be faithful. Would you look at the person on the other side? Say faithfulness. Faithfulness. You see, it's one thing to have faith. Faith means I trust God. Being faithful means I become trustworthy. And I want you to know, faithfulness is such an important thing. How many of you know today marriages are more under attack than they've ever been? Families are more under attack than they've ever been. And I want you to know, it's like unfaithfulness has just become an accepted norm in society. If you don't like your job, leave. If you don't like your partner, go. If you don't like how things are working in the church, go to another church. Got very quiet in this beautiful church this morning. Beautiful church. That's for all the elders that were mocking me yesterday. They say, I use beautiful for everything, you know. Beautiful day, beautiful info bar, beautiful church, beautiful people. Beautiful stewards. Beautiful congregation. But church, faithful, what does it mean to be faithful? It means to be trustworthy. Can God trust you to finish what you started? And you know when faithfulness is most tested is when you want to give up. When you want to stop doing what you're doing because you've now got bored or you've now had enough or things aren't working out the way you wanted them to. And so now the pressure comes onto you and onto your flesh and onto your soul to give up and just say, ah, you know what, I'll go do something else. No, stay faithful this year to the things God's asked you to do. Now, if we're talking in a church context, stay faithful in bringing your tithes and your offering this year. Stay faithful in staying committed to the things that you've put your hands to in the local church. I'm talking in a church context now. In a marriage context, stay faithful to your partner. Stay faithful to your children and to your job and to the things God has put in your life. Now, I'm not saying you can't make changes. I understand sometimes circumstances and life and God opens you to understand that, but then you've got to know in context that's what God's telling you to do. So in other words, you know, I was faithful serving in my church till God released me to start this church. So I wasn't unfaithful when I left to start this church because God sent me. Do you understand? You've got to evaluate things in the context of where you are. Number three, the third thing and the third course God wants us to stay on this year that is going to help us tap into the fast that God wants to do in our lives is number three is he wants us to be able. He said, be strong in grace. The things you've learned and heard, commit them to faithful men who will be able to tell others and to teach others. So look at the person next to you, say able. Or I'm not talking about Cain and Abel. I'm talking about ability. Would you just say that word nice and strong? Say ability. I'm really pastoring you this morning, and so maybe this isn't a rah-rah message, but let me just be honest with you. God is looking for people that have ability. He's not looking for lazy, washed out people that aren't willing to put effort in. Just smile, say we love the pastor this morning. Listen, God needs you and I to become skillful at what we're doing. God needs us to develop the talents that he's placed in our lives. And God wants us to take the things that he's given us and he wants us to use them. He doesn't just want us to use them. He wants us to increase them, to develop them, to be progressive, to be sharp, to be better than we were last year. Can you say amen? Let me pick on the instrument players. Our worship team is doing a great job, amen? And we've been put under pressure by different things that have happened, but can we just give them a round of applause this morning? They just keep on keeping on. And if you play an instrument, or you've got a beautiful voice, a beautiful voice. Then see Sean afterwards and commit to doing something this year in the church and join the band. But let me just talk to the band. Let me pick on the band this morning because I know they can handle it. You guys were amazing in 2016, but I need you to be better in 2017. Amen? Practice more. Seek God more. Learn new songs. Develop yourself. Why? Because listen, God is always on the move. Look at the person next to you, say, he's always on the move. 2/3 of God's name is? Let's try again. 2/3 of God's name is? You stand still, you miss God. Amen? No, I'm not. I'm just joking. But literally, God is on the move. I shared this with one of the guys in the church. I said, God doesn't promote you from a negative. God doesn't promote you from a failure into something fantastic. He promotes you from a place of strength and success into more success. Now you say, Pastor, are you picking on that? No. Listen, if you're failing in an area, if you're struggling in an area, understand that you're a candidate for God's mercy. You're a candidate for God's grace to help you through that situation. But here's the thing, don't stay in that situation. I want to encourage you this morning. If you've been failing for 22 years, it's time to stand up and say, what am I doing wrong? I need to change that. I need to let God transform something in my life. And I've been there where God's just said, Larry, I'm jerking the slack. You need to sort this out in your life now. It's time. Look at the person next to you. Say, it's time. Okay, do it with a bit of, give them a good slap. Say, come on, it's time. Why? Because God's looking for people that are able. And I'm not, if you're going through a hard time now, you're in a place, I'm not picking on you this morning. Because I've been in that place. I'm just saying, let God work in you in that situation. And take responsibility. You might have to make some transitions, make some hard choices. But God wants us to become able. Amen? God is looking for a people that are able. Do you still love me? Wow, that was quite weak, eh? But anyway, it's okay. I won't take it personally. Number four, the fourth thing. Paul, now remember, Paul is concerned about Timothy staying the course and causing the gospel to spread. He says, the fourth thing you're going to need is it says here, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier. Shoulder. Be a good shoulder, okay? As a good soldier. So the fourth thing is endurance. If you're going to stay the course, you need endurance. Can I tell you my little comrade story? Those of you who don't know, in 2011, I decided to run the comrades for the second time. And I decided I was going to run it to raise funds for our church building that we were going to buy, which wasn't the building God wanted us to buy. So I did it all in the flesh for nothing. Amazing. What a lesson to learn. But here's the thing. I trained and trained and trained and trained. And on the day, I ran and ran and ran and ran. And I want you to know, if you're going to run a marathon, you need endurance. Endurance. And God, in his absolute mercy and grace, when I was asking people to sponsor me, I didn't say sponsor me to finish the race on time. I just said, sponsor me per kilometer. I didn't realize that at the time, but it was God's wisdom, because it meant even if I didn't finish, the amount of kilometers I ran was what they'd pay me. Thank goodness for God's mercy. Anyway, I did finish the race, but not in time. I was 12 minutes short of the cutoff. And the thing that haunts me the most about that whole thing was 12 minutes over 12 hours. That's 1 minute an hour. It's nothing. If I could have just endured and cut off 1 minute in every hour, I would have made it in time. And that's the difference that endurance makes. You've got to keep at it when everything in you wants to quit. When everything in you is saying, listen, God, where are you? Nothing. No, you just stay the course. Stay enduring. Keep enduring. You know, I think about God's mercy that, you know, this past November, just 5 years ago, our team of leaders and elders were fasting and praying and spending time before God on a Wednesday night, just seeking God. And out of that, God promised us a building. And it wasn't the building we thought it was. It was this building. And isn't it amazing that in under 12 months, God gave us this building, gave us the money to pay for it, raised up the money. And so we've now been in this building for 4 years. But I thought about, imagine if we gave up on the fifth year. All that pain we went through, all those difficulties we went through would have come to nothing. But you know, thank God for awesome congregation. Thank God for awesome leaders that we just kept enduring. And today we're starting to see the benefit of endurance. Touch the person next to you. Say, endurance, endurance. William Barclay said this, endurance is not just the ability to bear through a hard thing, but it's the ability to turn it to God's glory. Amen? Are you getting some help this morning? I said, are you getting some help this morning? Amen. Amen. All right, we're nearly done. We're nearly done. Number five. The next sentence, Paul says, doesn't get any easier anyway. The next thing Paul says is this, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. According to the rules. This is probably the centerpiece of the sermon this morning. You and I don't win the prize if we don't compete according to the rules. Now, I know in a church society today that's all about grace, and I am all about grace. I would not be here if it wasn't for the grace of God. I understand the grace of God, and I don't think you ever reach the depth of God's grace or understanding, but I love grace. But I want you to know what you've got to understand is that grace gives you the power to follow the principles of God's word. And when I'm talking about rules, I'm talking about principles like gravity. How many of you know, you can say all you want, when I step off the building, I'm going to fly. I hope the cameraman's ready. The reality is when you step off the stage, gravity pulls you down. It's a principle. It's a law of life. Can you say amen? And I want you to know what Paul was saying to Timothy. He was saying, listen, there are certain rules of engagement that God has given you from the word of God, that if you don't apply those principles to your life, it's not that God doesn't love you. It's not that God doesn't want you to do better. It's not that God doesn't want to bless you. There are principles that you've got to apply, that God's put in the word, that God's put there as safeguards so that the enemy cannot destroy and stop what God's doing. So, I have a few minutes. I want to talk to you about my most embarrassing golf moment, which actually was the birth of this message, the depth of this message came to a reality on the golf course. I think I need to play golf a lot more and get a lot more messages. I'm just saying, maybe that's what the Lord's trying to say. Anyway, we're playing golf in December with my son and a friend in the church, and we decided on the day that when we play, we're going to play what they call skins. So skins is simply this, you play a hole, whoever wins that hole, you get 1 point. Okay, so there's not scoring and all sorts of other things going. So my son, very irritating, I love my son, but he's very irritating. He doesn't play golf for the whole year, and then when he does play, he's phenomenal. So we finished the first nine, and he has got 5 skins. I've got 2, and my other friend's got 2. So Dale's leading 5-2. So we start the second nine, and I'm like, come on, Larry, pull yourself towards yourself. I pray, and I say, God, you're on my side. Angels, you're going to help me. Don't help my son. And I'm not competitive at all. And so anyway, we start the second nine, and it goes very well. First hole, we halve. Second hole, we halve. We get all the way to the 8th hole, and we've halved every hole. So that means on this hole, which is a par 3 over the water, there are 8 points. In other words, whoever wins this, wins the day. So I'm up on the tee first, and I'm like, shh, this is my opportunity to shine. And I hit the ball, and it's a beautiful shot, but it's way left over the water into the reeds. I'm like, oh, dash. Anyway, my friend gets up. He hits the ball, and he hits it just short of the green, not into the water, but into the sandy bay, the sandy bank. So it's also not a great shot. He's in a bit of trouble. So now it's my son. So my son gets up, and I'm praying, Kuraba Shande. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for a bad shot. Oh, Jesus. No, I'm only joking. I wasn't doing that. No, I honestly wasn't. Anyway, he hits a shot, and it's not a great shot. It's right over the green, over the back, and my friend says there's water there, and it's in the water. So I'm like, no, there's no water there. You'll be fine. It's not going to be an easy shot. But we're kind of all in trouble. So I'm walking down, and I turn to them, and we're just having fun. So I said, you know what? We all hit terrible shots. Let's all have mulligans, which means a free shot. We'll just start again and pretend we never hit the bad shot. And my friend was like, yes, let's do that. And Dale was like, yeah. He walks back. He says, no, but wait, my ball might be all right. I'm not going to do that. So I'm like, okay. that's fine, your choice. And so I decide I'm going to walk this way, away from the green, over the, around the water, and I'm going to go and look for my ball. Hopefully I find it. Unlikely, but hopefully. Anyway, as I'm walking there, there's this old guy on his little scooter. He works for the course, and he was there busy directing some of the workers. And he says, good day. I said, hello. He says, are you looking for your ball? So I said, yeah. He says, come, I'll help you. And he drives on his little scooter. And he finds my ball. And I'm like, wow, awesome. Thank you, Jesus. Anyway, I go look, and the ball's not great. I'm kind of standing in the reeds. It's not excellent, but I'm like, okay, I can do this. And I hit a pearler. I hit a fantastic shot. Flies out of the over the water, lands on the green about 4 meters to putt. I'm like, go Tiger. Go Ernie. Anyway, my son has to drop out. My other friend duffs the shot. So basically, I have 2 putts to win the hole. I get my 2 putts and I win the whole day. I'm like, woo! Anyway, while I'm walking to play my shot, I start thinking, was that really my ball? I'm like, what had happened is 2 holes before I'd hit my ball into the water, and I'd just taken a ball out of my bag and played that ball, and I think it was a Schrickson. I'm sure it was, because that's what I played, but I wasn't certain. So now my conscience is starting to prick me. I'm like, I'm not sure that was my ball. Anyway, I putt, I play out the hole, I win the hole. Now I'm walking to the next hole, and now my conscience is really getting on my case. And I go to the guys, I say, listen, guys, just to be fair, I actually don't know if that was my ball. My son was like, he climbed all over it. He's like, yeah, you cheated, bro. I'm like, no, I'm just being honest with you guys. Let's play. Anyway, my friend, the picture of grace, or maybe it's just because I'm his pastor, I'm not sure. He says to me, no, don't worry about it. You won the fair and square. It doesn't matter if it wasn't your ball. Just next time you need to mark your ball. Now, here's the whole point of my story. I've been playing golf for years. I know the rules of golf. Firstly, if you lose your ball and you take out another ball, you've got to tell the other players. Number two, when you take your ball out, you've got to mark it with a cokey so that you know that's your ball. So when I got to the ball which the other guy found, the first thing I was supposed to do was check if it is my ball. Now, I didn't even mark my ball. I don't even know what ball I took out. So, listen, according to the rules of golf, I not only didn't win that hole, I was disqualified from the game. And so as I was walking home, and the more I thought about it, the more embarrassed I got, because I'm like, Larry, you know better. You know, if you're playing the game, then you play according to the rules. And suddenly I just realized, as Christians, sometimes we don't want to play according to the rules, but we want the benefits and the blessings that come from those who play by the rules. And the Apostle Paul was clear in 1 Corinthians 9. He says, listen, I bring my body under subjection so that after I preached, I might not be a castaway. And so I want to encourage you this year. It's not a nice story that I love to tell, but it was such a lesson to me in life, because I look back over my life for a couple of minutes and I realize there are some things that I missed out on, not because God's not good, not because God didn't want to do it, but because I refused to play by the rules. The rules of the gospel are clear. There's certain principles that, guys, you and I can't violate and then expect God to give us the benefit. Now, how many of God is merciful? God is gracious. Sometimes he even helps us when we're stupid. Have any of you ever been stupid before? God still helps us because he loves us and he's committed to us. But how many of, there comes a time where God wants you to grow up and say, you know what? I've got to get these things right in my life so that I can experience the blessing. My time's up. The last one, which we'll finish next week, he says, the hardworking farmer must be first to partake of the harvest. It's simply a picture of this, that you and I need to be like farmers. We can't give what we don't have. God wants us to experience the gospel. But we've got to understand, a farmer goes out, he tills the land, he turns the soil, he puts fertilizer, and he plants seeds. You don't get a harvest if you don't plant seeds. Can you say amen? And so I want to encourage you this year, let's be like the farmer. Let's go out there. Let's plant our seeds. Let's trust God. I believe God's going to fast track us. I believe our harvest can supernaturally grow, but God can't grow something you haven't sown. So let's be diligent and let's think about the principles of God's word and let's go sow the seed. And I'll close with this. You and I benefit. How many of you have benefited? How many of you are so glad that Jesus died on the cross for you? That you're born again and that you have been made brand new. That's all of us. Super glad. Here's the thing. The gospel benefits you, but here's the thing. God wants to fast track you, but more than that, He wants to fast track the message of Jesus Christ. The reason He wants you and I to be blessed, the reason He wants us to carry His glory is so that we can show others how awesome God is. So that we can lead them to Christ, so that we can preach the gospel. And I think in the church today, we're so busy applying the gospel to our lives and we just want the benefit and we want the blessing and there's nothing wrong with that. God wants you to be blessed. But listen, the reason He wants you to be blessed is so that you can be a blessing. Let's not lose track of why God saved you. God saved you because He's got someone else in mind that He wants you to reach, that He wants you to touch, that He wants you to impact with the glorious gospel. Can you say amen?